Hello, Joy Baptist Church. This is Evangelist Scott Pauley, and I am so happy to have the opportunity to sit down and talk with you today. I love your pastor. Brother Jay has been a real encouragement to me. What a beautiful family and a wonderful opportunity God has given your church there in that place. I know you have exciting days ahead, and I really like this idea where he's talking to you about making certain connections. Connections with God, of course, and connections with one another, and applying Bible truth to everyday life. He's asked me to deal today with a certain subject that I hope will be a real encouragement and blessing to you, and that is to talk to you about your home, your family. Now, let me begin, before we open the Word of God together, just to give you a brief word of testimony. I must confess to you that most of what I have learned about the Christian home, I have learned through one of two means, either through the successes of my parents growing up, watching their example, the things they did right, or by my own failures. Funny how sometimes we have to learn things by our own shortcomings and great mistakes, and I've had more than my share. I don't have all the answers, but I know this: God in His Word gives us a pattern to follow if we want our homes to be everything that He wants them to be. Personally, I'm very grateful for a godly dad and a godly mother who raised my sister and I in a truly happy Christian home. They raised us to believe not only that God's Word was right and God's way was right, but that it was also bright and that the Christian life was the happiest life on earth. Oh, I'm so very happy about that today. And I want that for my children. And Tammy and I, by the grace of God, are trying to instill that in them. I hope you'll pray for us. And I want you to know I'm praying for your family and for your church family, whatever stage in this you happen to be at right now. Maybe it's with children, maybe it's with grandchildren, or maybe you're a young person preparing, thinking about the future. I want to give you some principles today that I hope will be a great encouragement. I want you to open your copy of the Word of God with me to the New Testament book of Hebrews, because in the end, what I have to say is not really important. What God has to say is very important. And I want to show you a family. It's actually an Old Testament family, but they're mentioned in the New Testament because truth endures to every generation, and what's good for one generation is good for all of us. And the family I want to show you is found in Hebrews chapter number 11. We know Hebrews 11 as the great faith chapter, but look at verse number 8. The Bible says, "By faith Abraham," oh, we all know Father Abraham, but don't look just at the father. Pay attention to what happens with the children. You see, in a family, it's not just about now, it's about the future. It's about what we're going to pass on to the next generation. "By faith Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. And he went out, not knowing whither he went. By faith he sojourned in the land of promise, as in a strange country, dwelling in tabernacles," now here's the key phrase, "with Isaac and Jacob." Who are Isaac and Jacob? This is his son and his grandson. So notice here, three generations. Oh, don't miss this truth. The truth that God gives us in His Word is not just for us, it is for the generation coming behind us. We really are like tributaries. We're receiving and we're relaying. It's a relay race. You've been handed a baton, now it's your turn to pass it on. So, like dominoes falling, if you will, Abraham, then Isaac, then Jacob, and notice, they weren't just joined circumstantially by the fact they were family or they lived in the same place. Look at the end of verse number 9. "The heirs with him of the same promise." In other words, the truth that Abraham had to learn, Isaac had to learn it, Jacob had to learn it, and nobody can believe God for you. You got to believe God for yourself. As a matter of fact, look at verse number 11. It says, "Through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed." Also Sarah. Sarah is Abraham's wife. I can't even believe God for my wife. She must have faith in God. I must have faith in God. Our children must develop faith in God. Now, if you study the life of Abraham, you're going to learn one of the great secrets to him passing on his faith to the generations after him was this. Everywhere he went, Abraham did one thing. Do you remember what he did? There were certain things, of course, that were in the habits of the day, things like digging wells because you had to have water to live. But there was one thing that Abraham did everywhere he went. It was this. Abraham built an altar. Everywhere he went, Abraham built an altar. Why? Because Abraham understood that if he could worship God and lead his children and his grandchildren to worship God, if he could not only pray, if he could teach them to pray, then that would set in motion every good thing that God had for them. I would go so far as to say, when you look at his son and his grandson, all of the blessings in their life were somehow connected to an altar, and all the failures were connected to seasons in their life when they failed to build an altar. The old Bible commentator Matthew Henry said it this way, "Wherever man pitches a tent, God should have an altar." What did he mean by that? He meant by that that wherever you live, there in that place, not just in your church house, no, in your house, you should have a time and place where you meet with God and you teach your whole family what it means to worship the Lord together. Now, in the last few weeks, we have done that in a mandatory way because we've not been allowed to gather together at the church house. And I'm looking forward to getting back, aren't you? But in some ways, it's been a good reminder. It's a spiritual reset, if you will, for families, that families should have already been worshiping God together. Worship is not just reserved for Sunday. No, worship should enter into all of our life. And worship is not just what happens when the preacher gets up to preach. Worship should be us meeting God every day and teaching our children to do the same. There's an old expression you don't hear much anymore, and I think the reason the term has fallen into lack of use is because, frankly, you don't find this much in homes anymore. But years ago, they used to talk about having a family altar. Have you ever heard that expression, a family altar? What does that mean? Now, that doesn't mean you build a physical altar in your home that everybody kneels at. It's a spiritual principle. It means that in your home, you are determined that you're going to meet God every day and you're going to lead your family into the presence of God. It's very good to get ready and go to the church house. Very good. But I want to remind you that in the New Testament church, they not only met at the temple, but they met house to house. I'm not advocating a return to house churches, but I am advocating a return to family worship. When fathers and mothers worship God together, when fathers and mothers lead their children to worship God, I think we need an old-fashioned revival of the family altar. And so while there are many things I could talk to you about as it relates to the Christian home, I want to just press this one today, and it is this, that at this juncture, while we have to be at home, and before we return to our normal religious routines, one thing that needs to change in all of our homes is that as a family, we need to learn what it means again to gather around the Word of God, to pray, to talk to God, to praise the Lord, to worship God right in the privacy of our own homes. Friend, no one is a better Christian than the Christian they are in the privacy of their own home. So, what kind of Christian are you? If I wanted to know what kind of Christian you really are, I wouldn't ask your pastor. I wouldn't ask the people that go to church with you. I would ask the people that live under your own roof, because that's really where we must begin to live the Christian life every day. So let me give you a handful of suggestions. Now, we're not Abraham and Sarah, and we're not Isaac and Jacob, and thank God we don't have to live in tents out in the wilderness. But in our home, right where we live, we should have a family altar. So here are a few practical suggestions of how to apply this. First of all, set a time and place. Now, you don't have to be in bondage to this. It's not like a church service where there's a set hour that you have to be there. But I'm recommending that you set a time and place to have some spiritual emphasis with your family, because it'll help everybody to remember it. It will build it into our structure, into our lives. And soon enough, we're all going to be back to our busy schedules. And if we don't start this now and get this in our routine now, we may never do it. So set a time and place where everybody can be there. Set a time and place where everybody's wide awake and alert and can give their very best attention. Here's a second suggestion. Not only should you set a time and place, but secondly, I want to recommend to you that you remove all distractions. So what do I mean by that? I mean turn the TV off. Turn the music off, unless it's Christ-honoring music you're using for your family worship time. Lay the cell phone in the other room. That'd be a good suggestion. Because the devil's going to use anything, and the flesh is weak, to try to distract us from giving our full attention to the Word of God, to the Lord of the Word. So number one, set a time and place. Number two, remove distractions. Number three, make much of the Word of God. I'm not suggesting that you have to preach a sermon. In fact, I'm recommending that it may not be best to give a full Sunday school lesson and a lecture every day to your family. Instead, let the Word speak. Let God speak. Just open the Bible and read a portion of Scripture together. It may be a psalm, it may be a Bible story, but let God speak through the power of His Word. You may even encourage everybody to have their own copy of the Bible out. You may go around and let each person participate in the reading, but however you choose to do it, let the Word be at the center of your worship. You see, the Word of God always leads to worship. When God speaks to us, it makes it so much easier to speak to Him and to talk to each other about what God's talking to us about. So, set a time and place, remove distractions, make much of the Word of God. Number four, this is profound. Are you ready? Talk. This is the one thing we Americans are not very good at, because most of the time we have the television on or some distraction, or we're in such an all-fire hurry, we're running 100 different directions that we just don't talk. I want to recommend that maybe a good time to do this would be during meal times. Have a meal together. Sit around the table. Deuteronomy 6 says, when you sit in your house, talk about the things of God. Talk about the Word of God. Part of our problem is we don't sit in our house much anymore, not at least normally. But right now, begin that. Discuss what God is speaking to you about. Let every person give their thoughts. Don't belittle anybody's input. Let everyone participate in this. It doesn't mean that it has to be some long, lengthy discussion, but let us sharpen one another by talking about spiritual things. You know, honestly, it's a shame. It really is a shame that families can talk about work and school and ball and vacation and world events and not talk about spiritual things. That should never be the case in a Christian family. And then, let me give you this suggestion. Not only set a time and place, not only remove distractions, make much of the Word and talk, but number five, pray together. Talk to God together. Did you know you don't really know a person's heart until you hear them pray? So I'm going to suggest to you that you let every person voice their petition to God, and that you go around the circle, and then you pray for each person. Let your family members hear you call their name to God. Pray for one another and pray with one another. There's nothing quite like a family coming into the throne room of Almighty God together. That's what heaven is. Heaven is the family room for the child of God, and so it will help you. It'll be healthy for your family for you to let God speak, talk to one another about what God is saying, and then talk to God together. These are just a few practical suggestions on establishing what we might call a family altar in your home. Many years ago, a famous preacher by the name of Richard Baxter said that he went into a community to pastor a church, and the community was cold as ice. He couldn't get anything to stir or to happen. He tried everything. And finally, he determined he was going to try to get the people in his church just to begin praying and reading the Bible together. Do you know what happened? Revival broke out in that community. Why is that? Because I believe that when real revival comes, it doesn't necessarily just start at the church house. It starts at our house. That maybe the altar that needs the most use is not the altar at the church building. It is the family altar in our own home. Thomas Boston, another preacher in a bygone generation, took a pastorate. He said he preached and prayed and worked and labored for weeks and months. Nobody got saved. Nobody joined the church. Nothing happened. He was so discouraged. So he did this. He set appointments in every family, with every family in his church. He would go into the home. He would ask them to bring the Bible to the table. They would all sit around the dining room table. He would open the Bible. He would read a portion of Scripture. He would pray over every member of the family. And then when he was done, he would close the Bible. He would hand the Bible to the head of the household, and he would say, now you do this every day with your family. And he helped them to establish family altars. They said in a matter of weeks that there was a spiritual awakening in that town unlike anything they'd ever seen. Bars closed. Jails were emptied. The church house was so full you could barely get people in the place. People were getting saved and baptized and added to the church. And how did it happen? It happened when there was a revival of the family altar. So, we're talking about making connections. I can't think of a more important connection than your connection with God and your connection with your family. And those two things go together. I want to challenge you, no matter how many people live in your home, no matter what the schedules are like, I want to challenge you to begin this week to set aside some time every day to read the Bible, pray together, and worship the Lord as a family. Let's get back to the family altar, and I think we'll see God do some amazing things in our homes, in our church, and in our communities. Our Father, I pray for every family right now that You will set some things in motion that will last for time and eternity. Encourage fathers and mothers, grandparents, stir children and young people. Oh God, do something so out of the ordinary through this simple principle being put into practice. we will know God has changed us. We will know this is the Lord's doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. I bless Brother Jay and their church. Move them forward to the glory of God, and I praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, church, thank you for letting me spend a few minutes with you today. I'm praying for you, and I hope you'll pray for us. I'd like to encourage you. If you want a good starter point for your devotional time or your family altar, 5 days a week, Monday through Friday, I do a little Bible study online called Enjoying the Journey. And all it is a Bible study for 10 minutes, and right now we're going through the Psalms. You can find it on our ministry website, scottpauley.org, or you can find it on any podcast player. And it may be something you want to listen to together as a family and then discuss that Psalm and pray together. Maybe that'd be a good place to get started with this principle. But I hope you'll take the truth and put it in action today. I'm praying all of us will be connected to one another and connected to God like we ought to. And I appreciate you taking time to listen. God bless you.